Hello, everyone. This is your host, Anthony Abney of Financial Freedom. Today, I have a special guest, the Senior Director and Loan Officer of Cap-Corp here at the Enterprise Center, Mr. Courtney Wilborn. How you doing, sir?
Pretty good. Good afternoon.
Great, great. Well, today we are going to talk about the loan application process. Courtney is, as I said before, the Senior Director and Loan Officer here at the Enterprise Center, and he's going to tell us the do's and the don'ts of the loan application process. So let's say you are a small business owner and you're going in for $50,000 loan. Courtney, tell us first, when should someone start thinking about applying for a loan? Because they have to factor in how long it's going to take to get approval based off of when they need the money. Like, go through when a person should start thinking, all right, look, I need to get this loan thing together.
A business owner needs to first define what their product or service is. Mm-hmm. And then with the definition of their product or service, follow the demand and let the demand dictate what you actually need. And what I mean by that, when you're going through your business planning process, you're going through your forecast and you know exactly how much capital you have to start your business. That's when you start thinking about whether or not you need debt or whether or not you need an equity investor to support your project.
Okay.
And then if you are truly entrepreneurial and you haven't thought of a plan or written a plan, I would say taking the necessary steps to say, if I want to reach a certain volume of people, mm-hmm. and you know that you're limited with your access and ability, calculate what it would take to reach your population and how much it would take of invested capital in order to do that. And if you don't have enough and you're trying to figure out where your resources are coming from, that's when you're identifying your debt options, and that's when you're identifying your equity options.
Got it. I got it. So first step of advice you supposed to, or you tell someone to do is first figure out what your demands are for your business and what your needs are. Try to project it for that and take a look at your cash and say, all right, am I going to have enough money to meet this demand? Is that basically what you're saying? Okay,
yes,
got it.
You know
got
it.
So, all right, so people should do that, but what normally happens?
People start a business, they have a cash shortfall, their back is against the wall, or they've used up all of their own capital and didn't use borrowed funds or invested capital in the process. And so now they've exhausted all of their own internal resources. And with that, they're struggling to keep themselves afloat because they didn't plan in advance.
Mm-hmm. So would you say is that what typically happens every when you get a loan applicant coming in is that they haven't really thought this thing through and now they're in trouble? Or do you typically get good people, good cash flow managers?
I think you get all types. I think you get some folks who are entrepreneurially spirited, mm-hmm. eager to start. Some mm-hmm. folks are focused and thought-provoking. Some folks that are experienced borrowers might have a snag in their personal scope and they can't qualify for a traditional loan, or they literally would be in a impasse of, I want to move to the next level, so to speak, or I want to be more innovative, but I can't do it myself.
Okay.
So I need an external resource to support me.
Okay. And so when someone's applying for a loan, how many people should, or how many firms should they reach out to? To apply, should they try to apply for a loan through two or three sources, go to the bank, a CDFI, and, which, by the way, I want to get touch on that, where people can go to get loans.
I think it should be actually the exact opposite. I think that a borrower needs to interview the financial institution that they want to have represent them, mm-hmm. meaning when you go with your hand out, the financial institution is asking you a variety of questions. You right. need to ask them a variety of questions as, when do you pull my credit? When will you actually go through the process? How long is your process? What's your turn time for decisioning?
Okay.
And then allow that to be one of the key indicators of whether or not you want to do business with that financial institution.
Okay.
A little bit on the opposite side, where you don't want to have multiple people running your credit at the same time, because the negative effect is every time they formally pull your credit, your score drops. Mm-hmm. I don't know the exact percentage because the market has changed and each credit bureau will react differently, but you want to actually take the lead and investigate who is the best institution or organization to work for you.
Yeah.
The second part of that is whether it's a for-profit or nonprofit, a bank or non-bank financial institution, you want to make sure that you comprehensively understand what their criteria is for lending so that you're not putting an application in that's going to get rejected based on something that you forgot to ask.
Good, good. So you kind of touched on it already. The different places or financial institutions that a borrower can go to apply. Would you mind just talking about each one of those and the pros and cons of working with each one? So we said CDFIs, we said banks. Who else do we got?
Let's take a graduate school approach to how you would look at it. So there are three various tranches of banks. You have your supranational banks that operate across all 50 states. You have your super regional banks that operate across multiple states. And then you have your localized banks that operate within a localized community or within one state. So their charters are all going to be different. And the demand is going to be different. And the requirement of what it takes to underwrite a loan is going to be different. The second tier pool of what you would look at would be a non-bank financial institution, your credit unions, other credit agencies that exist there to support you. In some sake, you would say, for example, TRF, PIDC, they're non-bank financial institutions that manage other organization funds, but have the ability to lend, but have the same lending criteria as a bank would have. But the difference would be social impact or economic impact. Jobs created, jobs retained. So the criteria isn't based on a FICO score. It's based more on the demographical changes of how you're going to improve a community or an environment. So I spoke through banks. I spoke through non-bank financial institutions. And believe it or not, a few foundations will actually lend money in a form of what's called a forgivable loan, where if you reach certain levels of criteria of what they want you to follow through with, they will forgive the debt and it just becomes a grant. Then there are other organizations that will actually invest equity in your organization from a foundation standpoint, as well as from a non-bank financial institution, as well as from a bank's standpoint. And it's based on different programs that they have available, from a PRI, which is called a program-related investment, or an EQ2, which is designed in a way where they're investing equity into various organizations, or federal government granted agencies will also become a direct loan source, such as the SBA. Such as the USDA for food-based organizations, HHS, operating through Health and Human Services. All three of those where it's federal dollars impacted into a company, private dollars coming in through banks and non-bank financial institutions, as well as foundations.
All right. So those are the different institutions that a borrower can apply for a loan from. So let's start talking about the loan application itself. I just want to kind of highlight a few of the topics that are in basically every single loan application that you can get. And first, let's talk about the business plan. If I'm a borrower and I give a loan officer a business plan within my application, as the loan officer, what are you looking for in that business plan?
I'm looking for credibility. I'm looking for something that seems realistic. Mm-hmm. A lot of people will look at a target number. I want to be a millionaire. Mm-hmm. What does it take to become a millionaire? There are different stages. It's not going to happen overnight. There's a process that's built into that. So I'm looking for an executive summary to kind of really tell your story in a short macro level, but very precise. I'm looking for the details where you understand your demographic, who you're selling your product or service to at great length. Mm-hmm. I'm also looking for you to be able to clearly articulate how you're able to repay back debt if a loan is granted, what's your timeline of being able to repay that back. I'm also looking for your finances to be extremely strong enough where you understand your numbers of how every product you sell is going to generate this level of revenue. Mm-hmm. And then understanding what your cost of goods sold or your cost of service, and then understanding what are the expenses that support that. Then being able to clearly explain at the end of the day, if there's a net profit from each product that you sell, how is that going to help you grow your business? How are you going to advertise that business based on that product that's sold?
Okay. Let's say I'm an entrepreneur and I'm not really, financials aren't my thing. Mm-hmm. You know, I know how to run my business. I know how to sell my product, but the financials, It's not my thing. What type of advice do you give an entrepreneur who falls in that boat with applying for a loan when it comes to putting together their financial projections?
Take the time to allow your weakness to become your strength by focusing on what you're good at. But if you're not the finance type in the example that you just expressed, hire or find the resource that can support you for the area that you're weak. Mm-hmm. But in order for you to truly have your due diligence completed, take the time to understand the big picture. Mm-hmm. The big picture meaning if you don't understand ratios, but you understand revenue targets and you understand how much money you need to see at the end of the day, take the time to understand how it's what it's going to take for you to become a profitable business.
Right.
Or else define why you're doing this
right.
project. Mm-hmm. Are you in it to make the impact? Are you in it to provide food on the table for your family? Are you in it to make a difference in the world?
Yeah.
Either way you look at it, you still need to understand how do you begin it and then how do you end it?
Mm-hmm. All right. And so would you say as a loan officer that if an entrepreneur is, if their financial projections are, I mean, no one's financial projections are accurate, but if you see projections that just look way off, is this going to kill the loan?
No. What will happen is, as the loan officer, you have to be the reality checker, so to speak. Mm-hmm. When someone's vision looks lofty, you ask them to verify the information or to prove how they're going to accomplish the goal.
Yeah.
And what typically happens, for those that might not know, if you go to a traditional bank, they'll do what's called a counteroffer. And with that counteroffer, it's verified based on the accuracy of what they see in the numbers that you've presented.
Mm-hmm.
And so from 15 years of lending and 15 years of underwriting, it's truly an art in being able to understand the precision of what it takes for a deal to flow. So you'll have all the various 5 C's of credit. You'll have the analysis that's needed, but then you also have to use your gut in making a determinant factor on whether or not you truly support a business. Because the numbers could be wrong, but then you're able to look a person in their eye, or you're able to somewhat kick the tires, go out there and truly see what the applicant is doing with their business and make the determining factor of whether or not you want to do business with them.
Mm. And so, yeah, so let's talk about that. Let's talk about that. The determining factors to let you know you want to do business with someone. What type of personality are you looking for with a entrepreneur to let you know, okay, I feel comfortable with this person?
That's a good question. And it's a good question because there's no one true personality that you're looking for.
Mm-hmm.
It's somewhat like when you're dating.
Yeah.
I have a daughter. So, you know, you tell your kid, you know, I want you to be the best person that you can be in everything that you do.
Right.
And then you're also saying, well, put your best foot forward on the front end. But then life happens.
Mm-hmm.
And then all of a sudden, when you're looking at a borrower, they're telling you the sob story. And then I'm going, but who are you? Are you putting your best foot forward? Are you actually giving me the true you?
Mm-hmm.
And in dating, you know, you don't get the real person until much further into the relationship.
Right.
So I would say I start from the back, in the back.
Yeah.
I want to know the real person based on worst case scenario. Mm-hmm. I want to know when your business is sucking wind, you're not making a profit, who are you?
Mm-hmm.
How do you grow the business? How do you fix the mistakes? You've had to fire 5 people. You've come out of a bankruptcy. I want to understand that side of the person.
Mm-hmm.
When you're looking about looking and thinking about the personality, what a bank will do and what we will do here as well, we want to understand the management. We want to understand the personnel. We mm-hmm. want to understand how they deal with their people, because that will be the determining factor on seeing whether or not their business is going to be successful.
Yeah.
So when you analyze a business, everyone will talk about those 5 C's of credit that I referred to.
Mm-hmm.
When you're truly analyzing an organization, you need to look at an approach called CAMEL.
Mm-hmm.
And when you're looking at a CAMEL approach, you're looking at the capital, you're looking at the assets being managed, you're looking at the management of the organization itself, and then you're looking at the earnings, and then you're looking at the liquidity. I want to know how they manage their debt. So the way a bank is going to look at it, and the way we're going to look at you, and the way other nonprofits will look at you, they're going to pull your credit. And that credit is truly giving us somewhat of a personality indicator. But it's not the end result of who the person is, but it just gives us a, hey, do you pay your bills on time?
Mm-hmm.
And if you don't, then we understand that there's an issue. And then if you don't pay your bills on time and it was a health scare, something that went wrong, then we want to be able to understand, well, how did you run your business when things were going great? So then we'll take the step in saying, all right, let's take a look at what your financials look like. Mm-hmm. If your financials seem standard, then we understand, okay, there was a hiccup along the road. They focused on their business and didn't do anything for themselves personally. But in understanding a business owner's personality, you can only go by what's on paper. And right. Then your gut instinct is going to come out when you kick the tires and you see how they're running their operation.
Mm-hmm. Guys, that's really insightful. So let's get back to the loan application. So we talked about the business plan. We talked about the financial projections. Now let's start to talk about the documentation and the paperwork that goes along with the application. So first one I wanted to talk about was tax returns, both business and personal. Is that different for each financial institution, or does everyone want the same thing, basically, for your tax returns?
There's some standards that an organization is going to ask you. I'm going to speak from an elementary standpoint first. A business needs to know who they are. Mm-hmm. And what I mean by that is I'll ask the question, how are you structured? What do you mean by that? Are you an LLC? Are you an S-Corp?
Right.
Are you a limited partnership? What's the share of ownership that you have? Some of those things are things that they didn't think about because they've just been in their grind. Are you a sole proprietor? And by you defining who you are, that's going to be the determining factor on what documentation you need to present. Mm-hmm. So if you're a startup company, you haven't gone through that structural identity, that's the first series of information you need to do in being organized.
Okay.
The second series of information you need to support that information for submission would be a series of tax returns. So depending on the structure, you'll either need a 1040 with a Schedule C and Schedule E for collateral and identification for the business. Or if you are an S-Corp or a C-Corp, you'll use a 1065, 1065S, or an 1120 or an 1120S mm-hmm. tax form, depending on your structure. Mm-hmm. And then from there, a bank is able to determine who you are.
Yeah.
From a credibility standpoint, they typically will ask for a minimum of 2 years. And if you're a startup company, they'll ask for a business plan that kind of complements that, along with a copy of your personal tax returns for the most recent year. Mm-hmm. And if you've not completed tax returns and you have a business plan and it's interim financials of what they'll look for. So they would ask you to pull information from QuickBooks or Quicken in order to support. And if you haven't become that technologically efficient, they'll ask you just to show us that you understand a balance sheet, income statement, or cash flow statement.
Great. All right. So that covers the tax returns. So they need to know their structure. And then based off of their structure, that's going to determine the tax returns that they'll get. So they should have someone who's helping them with their taxes. So that shouldn't be an issue. So then let's talk about personal history. What type of questions or should a borrower be prepared to answer when it comes to personal history on the loan application?
Sure. The very first is a lot of times people are very sensitive about who they are. The thing that's important is that you want to make sure that you're okay disclosing your social security number. Mm-hmm. The second thing that you want to be very comfortable and confident with is we're going to ask you intimate questions about you.
Right.
Not your business, but you. What assets do you hold? What debts do you have? What liabilities are out there with that? What's your true net worth? What are your streams of income? What are your other supported means of income? Mm-hmm. Child support, judgment, hearings, things of that nature, benefits, some form of a beneficiary, a benefit to you will be asked. Some of it's for your personal gain in reviewing the personal history of an application. Some of it is to gauge whether or not you can handle a debt load. So if you have an extremely high debt amount, it allows us to really say, hey, let's take another look at who you are as a borrower. Mm-hmm. Not so much just as to who you are as a person, but what kind of risk are we truly dealing with? Mm-hmm. And that's what we're looking at in personal history.
Thank you, everyone, for listening in today with our special guest, Courtney Wilborn, the Senior Director and Loan Officer here at the Enterprise Center, Cap-Corp. I hope you guys learned a ton about the loan application process. I know I did, and this was helpful for me. And until next time, I'll see you guys later.
Hello, everyone. I'm Ryan Martin, the production consultant for The Grit Live. If you have any feedback or would like to be featured on this program, please email us at thegritlive.com. eatsforequity@gmail.com. Join us Thursday, May 3rd at Eats for Equity, a special fundraiser showcasing the Center for Culinary Enterprises and some of the businesses that you've heard on the Grit Lives programming. For more details, visit e4e2018.eventbrite.com. That's e4e2018.eventbrite.com. Thank you for listening.